good to see you guys this morning. Well, we are right in the middle of a series, Furiously, right? And it's about worship. And so I'm coming up here today and I want to have a conversation with you. I have been assigned the task of how our singing, our worship makes a difference, okay? So I'm going to talk about that. You know, the Vineyard Community Church is part of a larger movement of Vineyard, of the movement of the Vineyards around the world. And so at the core of who Vineyard is being able to have a core value of wanting people to experience God in their time of worship, whether it's personal worship or corporate worship like what we're doing here today. And so this experiencing God is at our foundation. It's who we are as a movement. So with this rich history that we have actually led conferences all around the world helping people to achieve that intimacy, that touch of God when they're worshiping. And while we're doing that, we do know that no matter how much music is great or the singers are or the musicians, you know, all those things, that really in being able to encounter Christ, being able to encounter God during worship is more about the part that we play. It's more about what we want, if we're wanting him to touch us, right? Now, I know the scriptures tell me that God is eager to be known. He wants us to be know him better, and he wants us to experience him in his fullness. And so listen, he is searching for us, right? He is wanting to draw us close to have this intimate relationship with him. He's the one who's searching us out. He's the one who's igniting this relationship. All we need to do is just to respond to it. And the place that we learn to respond to it is in worship. That's its primary place. That's where we get nurtured and we develop, you know, in the singing and in the worshiping of God. That's where we come close to God. And as I said, Vineyard Community Church is very experience-based in its worship. So it's not just knowing about it, it's actually doing it and engaging in it. And when we do, it ignites a power in us that goes way beyond what we can imagine, and it actually helps us to be able to live fully as children of the God Most High that we were created to be. So my prayer for you today is that you would be able to experience God in a tangible way when you worship, right? And that you would be able to increase your sensitivity to him and your receptivity to the Holy Spirit, which is God's presence moving on you. Now, as I said, I was assigned being able to talk to you today about, you know, how our singing makes a difference. And I thought about it, and I thought, really? That's so hard. I feel almost like when I sing, I feel like I'm a blind woman trying to discover, you know, or trying to tell you about like the color yellow, and you guys are blind. So it's a very hard task, one that I can only embark on with the Holy Spirit's presence and with his help. So why don't you bow your heads with me, and we're going to ask him to come even more. Father God, I thank you, and I release you, Holy Spirit, to move more and more. God, would you please take down barriers that are erected up, Father, for protection? Would you bring them down? Would you put peace in the heart of each and every person here, Lord God? Let them know how much you love them and care for them. And Holy Spirit, just govern my words, watch my words. Father, help me to portray your heart honestly and forthrightly as you have spoken it into me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, guys, you know, I've been doing pastoring for a long time. In this particular church, I've been its pastor for 21 years. And so I've seen a lot of people's attitudes about worship. I've experienced it firsthand. You know, and there's very few people that really get what worship is. The majority of people don't seem to. I know that some of the attitudes I've seen are people that look at the worship service and they go, ah, it's just the warm-up, the warm-up exercise to the main show, you know, the sermon, you know, so they'll come in late and maybe not participate. And then I've seen other people that have come in and they look at worship as like an entertainment piece or performance piece. And so they evaluate, you know, how were the singers, were they in tune, you know, were the instruments keeping the beat, was the atmosphere, right? And so they evaluate like a performance, how's it going? And still others would evaluate their worship experience based on, did they play the songs that I liked, you know? Was the volume at the loudness or quietness, whatever that I wanted? You know, were people around me worshiping or were they too emotional or not emotional enough? Did we sing too many songs or not enough? And so they evaluate, listen, I've seen all kinds of attitudes about worship. And I want you to know, if those are any that you struggle with, that God is inviting you today. He has so much more than that. He's got so much more for you to experience this fullness of who he is in the worship experience. And that's what I want to talk to you today about. So what I've done is I've prepared for you today these ideas, these concepts that I think help to initiate God's presence and to experience him in our life when we worship. So these are not in chronological order. These are ideas that I've had, that I see, that I've been part of in the movement, and I know that they help to usher the Holy Spirit in and usher a touch by God. So I hope that you can kind of, you know, just kind of go with the flow today with those. I've also, on your outline, just did a real minimal because I wanted you to pay attention because I think this is more caught than it is taught, okay? And so here you go. I put some on your outline. I put, you know, action steps or whatever. You can look at those in your devotional time, quiet time this week. But let me just kind of introduce you to some concepts that'll help you to have a richer time when you're in worship. So on your outline, let's look at that. Seven responses to God's initiation towards us in worship. So this is about postulating your heart, and these are questions that you need to come up with. You need to line your heart up with. The first one is where we go, I want to know you, God. I want to know you, God. In other words, you want to encounter God. You know, you want to have this God encounter. And that's what you need to open yourself up to. Listen, when you guys come here, when you come here and you come down that hallway, here's what I want you to see. I want you to see that God is waiting for you. God is waiting for you. He's in this auditorium. He's anticipating you coming, and he's wanting to be with you. Just like Andy or I will stand at the door and we greet you, God's here. God's here, and you have an appointment with him. He wants to see you. And so worship is this place where we go and we encounter him. So how do we encounter this invisible God, right? How do you encounter invisible? You see my face, you give me a hug, right? Say hi. But how do we do that with God? Well, I like to think of it this way. I like to think of it just like meeting a new person, you know? If you're going to meet a new person, I want you to think about this, right? If you're going to meet a new person, you want to know something about them. So you make it your business to try to figure out who they are, what they like, what they don't like, what their heart is. And you figure that out. And then you arrange a meeting so you can go and that you can meet with them. And then it's in that exchange, in that meeting time, that you begin to see the evidence of what you've learned manifest itself. And you go, oh, that's why you do what you do. That's why you say what you do. And so it's all about experiencing that person where it comes alive, right? Well, experiencing God's presence happens in a similar way. We need to know God. And the way we know God is through his word. His word tells us all about who he is. It tells us about his likes and his dislikes, right? It talks about his heart, you know? And so we really need to do the work of studying who he is outside of this meeting that we have. We need to get that fresh start, that knowledge of who he is in our hearts as well as our heads. And so when we come to worship, we're bringing that in with us. And then it's here that the Holy Spirit embraces us and he talks to us. And the experience of all that we read starts to become alive to us, and it starts to make sense. You know, it says in the Bible in Psalm 42:2, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? And so there's this heart cry, and I know that's my cry. Where can we go to meet with God? Where can we have this encounter? Is it not the cry of every believer to want to hear the Father's voice in their life? Sure it is. Sure it is. And worship is that place. It's that time that we get to connect with the Lord. And so here you go. The first thing I want you to do is I want you to challenge yourself to reframe the way you think about worship. Listen, God is here. He's waiting for you. He's looking in that down that hall, you know, hallway, and he's waiting for you to come in here. He's waiting for you to take your seats. He's so excited that you're here because you matter to him. Right? And then once we get that idea that he's waiting, then we'd be running to this auditorium. I know I would. If I could keep that in the front, you know, in the front of my face, I'd be running down here because I'd want to be where he is. And this feeds right into the next perspective. I think we need to challenge our heart to have a heart that says, I want to be touched by you, God. I want to be touched by you. Right? So there's this expectation that God is not only here, but that he wants to touch you and touch you in tangible ways, ways that you can feel him, right? See, God not only is here for you, he loves you. He loves you, and he accepts you, and he wants to touch you. And we need to anticipate that touch coming in. We need to anticipate that he is drawing us in. You see, it says in 1 Peter 1:8, though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible joy and glorious joy. And so what the author here is saying, the apostle, he's saying that there's extraordinary beauty in this idea that even though we can't see God, God makes himself known to our heart. Even though we can't see him, he makes himself known to our heart. To me, what we're talking about is kind of what I experience with the wind. You know, when I'm outside and the wind starts to blow, I know it's blowing. I cannot see it, but I can feel it on my skin, and I can see the evidence of it on myself and everybody around me. So God's like that. He comes in, and I know some of you, you've been in a time of worship, you know, and you just felt overwhelmed by God's love and his, you know, his love, his acceptance of you, and it just kind of overwhelmed you. That's God's presence. That's God's presence. But here you go. I think he wants that every time you come in here. I think he wants to give you those. I think he wants to meet you and touch you in those very special ways. And here's what I've noticed. To draw close to God, he draws close to those that have faith to believe that he wants to speak to them, that he wants to encounter them. And for me, the experience of drawing close to God is all about coming into a room and listening for that quiet voice in a very loud room. Right? And focusing in, where is he at? And trying to find that voice. Trying to find that voice. So here's how it applies to us in worship. We have to quiet ourselves. We have to dial down, dial back, and then quiet ourselves to hear that voice of the Father. Hear that voice and look for that experience that he wants to give us. So we have to get quiet, which means we have to push away all the things that happened this morning, all the things that happened this week, right? All those things we got planned for this afternoon, we have to push all those away so that we can focus on God and hearing his voice. Now, I'm just like you. I come in here and I've got 1,000 things. I am the queen of multitasking, right? And so I will come in here and I'll start to worship God, but my mind is just running wild. And when I capture my thoughts and I focus it in and I look for the voice of the Father, I look for it when I'm singing. I look for him and I listen. I can hear him say, oh, there you are, Sharon. I've been waiting for you. And it's so impact to me, just even telling you, I can feel the intensity because I feel so loved. I feel so wanted. It's in those places when you allow the Father to come close to you that he fills you up like you would not believe. And I've also found that when you and I can walk away from our need to control, you know, our need to protect ourselves, right? So somehow we feel like if we're vulnerable, if we're open, that we're going to get hurt. But if we can just drop down our guard, that God can touch you. He can touch your soul in such profound ways, it will blow you away. That's what the Father wants to do. He wants to embrace you. And so I encourage you to put your hands down. You know, you don't have to protect him. You can just be open and let him speak to you. Let him come in and tell you how much he loves you, how much he cares about you. Now, in my time of prayer, I kept hearing this. No, we must keep God at a distance. We must keep an arm's length. And I kept hearing that over, and I was like, Father, what is that? And that's because there are many of us, and we know, you know, that we mess up all the time, that we fall short. You know, we know that we're sinners. We're very acquainted with that fact. That we're bloody screw-ups is what I say, right? And we know that, and so we think that we have to keep God at a distance because he's holy and we're not. But listen, God loved you so much that he sent his son. He sent him to you, not to condemn you. He didn't send him to condemn you, but to bring salvation, to bring you hope. That's what God did, and he did that because he wants a relation with you. He wants a relationship where you guys have this intimate exchange with him. That's what he wants for you. And I tell you, if you can't walk around with the grace that we have in Jesus Christ, or you've never experienced it, at the end of my time with you, I'm going to pray. And I want you to pray. Pray with me. Pray and believe that he will answer that. See, his MO is to love you, and we need to expect him to forgive you, and not just once, but continuously. I have to ask all the time for forgiveness because I'm always messing up. Just ask Andy. He'll tell you, or my boys. So I'm always asking God for forgiveness, confessing what I did. And you know, he's faithful every time, every time. But I've got to expect that he will give that to me when I go to ask him. So when we want to encounter the presence of God, we have to expect that he's going to be there, that he loves us and cares about us enough. The next heart that you want to cultivate is this one. I want to meet with you, God. I want to meet with you. So it's the I want to now. So it's this entering in. And this entering that I'm talking about, entering into what? Entering into the presence of God is going to cause you to do some things like worship. How do we worship? We sing, right? But there are many, many ways. In Psalm 100, verse 4, it says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. So what we're talking about is after you realize he's here and he wants to engage you, then you've got to want to engage him. You've got to want to start to talk with him, right? And there's this attitude that takes place of being thankful. When we are thankful, when we begin to understand the great, you know, and get in touch with our gratefulness of what God has done for us, and we start to sing that to him and we start to talk to him about that, there's nothing more in the Bible that I see that God's presence doesn't go, bam, because he inhabits the praises of his people. And so when we have this heart that comes and sings like that, then that invites the Holy Spirit, that invites God's presence right where you're at. You see, singing is so powerful, not just because it can evoke your emotional and your mental part of you, but it's so, so powerful because those songs, what they do is they usher you into the presence of God. They actually have power to transform you. I like to think about singing songs that they matter so much that I want to give you a word picture, okay? Here's my attempt at this one. For me, singing is like a doorway, all right? Worship are songs that are designed to be entered into, that you walk into. So the song is the doorway that you open and you walk into to experience it. And what happens is you become on the other side of the door. It's a whole world, a whole spiritual world that opens up for you. So you see, singing is not about just singing about God. It's singing to God. It's singing to God. It's coming right before his throne and singing to him. It's that place that you get to meet him, that place that you get to talk to him. And I tell you, in corporate worship, like what we've got going on today, right? These songs, they matter. They help to usher in the presence of God in your life. And so what I do often is I get a visual of me entering into worship, like I reach for that door, right? And I walk in, and I see myself actually standing before my Father in heaven. I actually see that. And so the songs, I make them very personal. They're my songs to my Father in heaven, right? And so a lot of times when we're singing a song and it's, we will shout for your glory. Oh no, I go, I will shout for your glory. I make it all so personal because I know that I'm talking to a very personal God and inviting him into a relationship with me. So we want to make sure that we have this heart that uses the music, that uses the words of songs as an anthem, as a way of communicating to the Father when you have his full attention because you've opened the door and now you're singing to him. Isn't that cool? What do you give God of the universe? You give him your love. You give him your words. You praise him for who he is. The next thing you want to cultivate is number 4, I want to honor you, God. I want to honor you. In other words, I want to exalt you. I want to tell you how great you are. Right? And that needs to be on our hearts all the time. John 4:19 says, we love because he first loved us. This whole idea of the dance of love, the dance of worship was all initiated by him. It's all about him. He loves, he cares so much for you. He knows everything about you. And here's a word for you today. He knows not only you, he knows what you care about. And he says he'll never leave you nor forsake you, that he will always be there no matter what is going on around you. His peace can be had. He is here for you because you matter greatly to him. He cares so much for you. And I think in light of all that he has given to us as believers, that we need to be caught up in all that consumed, in all the love that he has, and just continue to reach for him, you know, and proclaim that love over our lives. We need to make sure that we feel that we're going there, that we're acknowledging that love he has. In Psalm 107:1, it says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." His love endures forever. He wants you to know that he's always here for you, and his love is so great and so huge, and he wants to engulf you in his presence. Listen, I know I've experienced a lot of this. About 10 years ago, feels like just yesterday, my father passed away. It was hard. I remember telling Andy, we were talking, we brought him here to do this service, and I said to Andy, "I don't think I can do this. My heart's just, you know, so full of grief and over the loss. I just don't think I can do this at all." And I remember the worship leader at the time, he came and he sat with me, and we were doing the service, and he goes, "What songs do you want?" And I looked at him, I go, "I don't know." You know, have you ever hurt so much you just don't know? I go, I don't know. Just talk about God's love. And so that the day the service came and my dad's casket was here, and I remember sitting there looking at it, thinking, you know, how sad, how overwhelmed I felt with the grief. And I thought, oh my gosh, it was so hard to breathe. And as I was sitting there, the worship started, and I stood up, and then I started to worship. And let me tell you, I don't know what songs we sang. We started singing about God's love, and I can remember to this day how God came in the midst of my grief and my sadness, how he came and he brought his peace and he brought his comfort to me like I've never known. And it went way beyond the circumstance that I was sitting in. And it was because I elevated the fact that I understood that he loved me. And he came in and he swooped me up. Why do I tell you that very personal story? Because that's what he wants to do for you. He wants to be there for you in the midst of your trials and your tribulations, the places that you hurt, the places that you feel like, "God, I just need your touch." My friends, he wants to touch you. And so if you will focus on his love, your heart will be so overwhelmed and you will be filled. You'll be filled. Now, the next thing I want to talk to you about is expressing. It's this heart that says, "God, I want to praise you. I want to praise you. I want to find ways of expressing my love for you." And what I see here is in Psalms 134:2, it says, "Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise the Lord." Circle, lift up your hands, okay? Lift up your hands. Now, there are lots of physical ways that we can praise God. Lots of them. And I put some of them down there so you can see. We can bow, we can clap, right? We can sing, we can dance, kneel. I mean, there's so many different forms that you can do it. But here's the thing, God has given us permission, even in the book of Psalms, he's given you permission to try all kinds of things. He wants you to try them. And I tell you, here at Vineyard Community Church, some of the things that we try to help you to be able to find different ways of expressing, right, are when the worship team's up here and the leader, you know, we'll be singing a song and all of a sudden the leader will tell the instruments to stop, right, or the vocalist to back off their mics. You know, and then we're singing, all of a sudden you can hear, we go, "Ah, ooh," right? It's almost like we feel like we're in an audition or something, you know, or did we really know the words, you know? But really what's happening is they're stopping because they know that God wants to hear from you. You're the main course. They're just side dishes. And so it gives you an opportunity to sing. Another thing that we do is we do what we call free flow worship. So when we're singing a song and then all of a sudden the worship people, you know, will go off the words, right? And they'll just start singing, you know, a melody or something like that. And here you go, you can join with them. That's that pause. That's that time where you can sing what's in your heart. I love those places. I love, because it makes me stop and think about what I'm singing. It gives me a chance to say, "Yes, God, what's inside of here? What do I want to bring out? Find my words to tell you." And it's at that time I love to sing to the Lord. Now, I can't sing worth a darn, but I do love to sing to him. I love to do that free-flowing worship. There are so many things that we can do, so many things. Now, let me tell you this also, bring this up. It's a thought I had. You know, I have a Catholic upbringing, which means that I was taught to reverence God. And boy, hasn't it served me well in my life. I sure do reverence him, and I sure do love him. But in that particular upbringing, I wasn't overly expressive, right? So for me to do anything but to kneel and to stand, right, and read out of a hymnal was a big deal for me. So when I started encountering that God wanted my whole body involved, right, it was very hard for me. And I know it was hard because of the way I was brought up. Now listen, if you came to a football game with me, you would know that I have no problem yelling, doing a chant, and doing a yahoo, you know, at all. Matter of fact, I embarrass Andy at times, right? I love it, especially if my kids are playing. Then I go wild, you know, because I'm invested. Okay, I have no trouble with that. But when it came here, there's like this pressure. And here, is it just me? Or am I speaking and you're like, yeah, I get you, girl. I know what you mean, right? There's just like this pressure. Like, gosh, I can't do that. Well, I want to release you today. Yes, you can. You can. If God can move this little old Catholic girl to get up and raise her hands, be able to speak in tongues, to be able to embrace God, to fall on her knees, to fall on my face sometimes when I'm worshiping, then he can do it for you. So here you go. If you trust me, I want you to try something with me. Right now, right where you're at, I want you just to open your hands like this and just lift them up, palms up, just like this. All right, good. Good, I know you are going, oh my God, what is she going to do? Right? Okay, palms up. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to lift them up and I want you to repeat after me. Lift them up. Just say, Father God, I love you. And I release everything that would keep me from worshiping you with my whole body. I trust you and I worship you. Amen. Amen. Now, did anybody fall over and die? No, the sky didn't fall in, did it? It's that easy. There are times when we are worshiping and my hand has to go up. It's almost like, ooh, me, God, me, right? We want to be able to use all that God has given us and he's given us a body. Now, the last two things, they kind of go together, and I wanted to leave time today for us to go back into worship so you can practice some of these things. And so let me just quickly go over these last couple of points with you. Number six, this is as a result of spending time with God, this encounter I'm talking about. Number six, we develop a, I want to glorify you, God. I want to glorify you. That means I want to be engaged with you. See, when we come to a place and we actually experience God all around us, right? It's a game changer, man. It's a game changer when you know that he's here and you start to grow in confidence that he's speaking with you and that maybe he even tells you something for somebody else so you can go pray for them. It's a game changer. It really is. And in Romans 12, 1, it says this, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. So what the apostle was saying here is that in his day and in his time, he was talking to the followers of Jesus Christ that lived in Rome, and they did sacrificing, right? Well, you and I can't relate to that as much. But here's what is being said. When you and I give our lives to Jesus Christ, and we ask him to be the leader of our lives, right? We must lose our life to find it. We become a living sacrifice. We lay our desires, our dreams, our hopes, we lay all that down, and we want to pick up Christ. And the more you come to worship, the more you encounter him and he touches you, the more you know that your ways are not anything, and you want to pick up his mantle, and you want to run with it. You want to engage with him. You want to be part of God's divine plan for humanity. It burns inside you because you love what the Father loves, and the Father loves people. And he wants them to bring him close, and he wants to bring him home, and you want to be part of that, and it's an outgrowth of your worship. The last one here is, the heart is, I want to become aware of you, God. I want to become aware of you, God. So there's this experience. So what's happening now is we've got this idea that's going on that God, you're here, and you've taught me how to be strong, and I want you, and I'm you know wanting to pick up your agenda. And so what happens is you want to start to experience him like that everywhere. Everywhere you go, whether it's in your home, in your marriage, in your relationships, at school, in your friendships, you know. And so everything becomes a God encounter. God, what do you want to do? Sometimes I'll be standing at the you know, the little checkout, the Kroger checkout. I'm standing there waiting for my turn. And if I'm careful, I can ask the Lord, you know, what do you want to do? You know, I say be careful because he always answers. And so here you, and if I'm in a hurry, that poses a problem. Well, anyway, you know, if you ask, he'll tell you. I want you to go tell that, say that to that lady. Say that to that man. Go help that. Tell that kid he did a good job bagging groceries today. You know, so he's constantly talking to us. He wants to infiltrate every part of our being, and we want him there, and we want to ignite that. In James 4:8, it says, come near to God, and he will come near to you. Let me tell you, when you come near to him in worship, it impacts more than your time here. You carry that all throughout your day, all in your relationships. Everything, it becomes God-filtered at that point. So I said I wanted to experiment with you guys, right? So we want to go back into worship, so I want you to stand up. The worship team, yep, you guys can make your way back around here, and we're going to do some more worship, right? And I want you to experience God. Go for the experiencing that I've been talking about, not just singing about God, but singing to him, okay? And if you need ministry and stuff like that, at the end of our time together, I will be up here to pray for you and to do ministry with you. But right now, what I sense God doing is he wants to move, and you get to release that in your life. You have control. So bow your heads with me, and I'm going to pray some of the things that God has put on my heart. Yes, Father. Father, I just ask right now that your Holy Spirit would even come more. I know I can feel the hearts. They started, they're beating loud. God says that he won't come close to you unless you want him to, because he loves you. He said, I will never transgress. He says, I'm never going to push in where you don't want. I won't do that to you because I love you too much. Father, you are such a respecter. I thank you, Lord, that you're in this room, that you're present. Mm-hmm. And Father, right now, I hear that. Father says that there are those that arm's length stuff. You went, that's me. And so right now, I'm going to invite you to pray a prayer with me right where you're at. Okay? You need the grace of Christ in your life. That's the only way it enters in is through Jesus. So right where you're at, if you want to be able to experience that grace, you just say, Father God, I want to experience this. And so I accept your Son, Jesus Christ, as my Savior and my leader and the forgiver where I have fallen short. I give you permission to just come and wreck my life. All right, let me pray for you. Father God, I thank you that your presence is here, and I ask right now in the name of Jesus, and I have been faithful, Father, to give these words that you gave me, and so I pray them back over these people that had ears to hear what the Spirit is saying, that you would release in them, Father, the ability to sense your presence, to hear your voice, that they would have the ability to speak in languages that are not their own. Yes, Father. Even that scary thing. And then, Father, that you would release prophecy, Lord. That you would take away the veil, Father God, so that there would be nothing that stood between them and you. Okay. And then, Father, I also remove, in the name of Jesus, performance. Father, take that away. Give them the vision of a child loving its father and running into its arms and climbing onto its lap and giving their dad a hug and a kiss. I thank you that you give us that. And you are a loving Father, and you will not reject. And so, Holy Spirit, just come and be in the midst of our worship now. In Jesus' name, amen.